Well, good morning, Woodlands Church. My name's Doug, in case we haven't met. We want to extend a welcome to you, whether you're in this room, you're in the chapel, or are watching online. This morning, as we begin our time of gathered worship, we want to focus our hearts and our minds on who it is that we've come to worship. And so we're going to hear from him through his word. And this is from Psalm 145. And it says this. It says, I will exalt you, my God, the King. I will praise your name forever and ever. Every day I will praise you and extol your name forever and ever. Great is the Lord and most worthy of praise. His greatness no one can fathom. One generation commends your work to another. They tell of your mighty acts. They speak of the glorious splendor of your majesty. And I will meditate on your wonderful works. They tell of the power of your awesome works, and I will proclaim your great deeds. They celebrate your abundant goodness and joyfully sing of your righteousness. The Lord is gracious and compassionate, slow to anger, and rich in love. The Lord is good to all. He has compassion on all he has made. All your works praise you, Lord. Your faithful people extol you. They tell of the glory of your kingdom and speak of your might. Oh, that all people may know, so that all people may know your mighty acts and the glorious splendor of your kingdom. Your kingdom is an everlasting kingdom, and your dominion endures through all generations. The Lord is trustworthy in all his promises, in faithful in all he does. This is who we've come to worship. So will you please stand as we sing his praises this morning?
Now New glories I see.
And let's sing of his great worth. Worthy of every song we could ever sing, and worthy of all the praise we could ever bring, worthy of every breath we could ever breathe, we live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever say, worthy of every breath we could ever breathe, we live for you. Song we could ever sing, worthy of all the praise we could ever bring, worthy of every breath we could ever breathe, we live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever say, worthy of every breath we could ever breathe, we live for you.
Shaken, I will build my life. foundation. I will put my trust in you alone, and I will not be shaken.
Would you please pray with me? Gracious Heavenly Father, we come before you today recognizing your infinite worth, your majesty. We've gathered here in your presence as your people, a portion of your church, different backgrounds, opinions, and experiences, but united by our need for you. And Father, we recognize that we've sinned against you in thought and word and action. You are holy, holy, holy. Yet we fail daily, and we seek your forgiveness. Thank you for providing a way for us to be reconciled with you through the death and resurrection of Jesus. Thank you for your heart to see all peoples across the globe turn to you for salvation. Thank you that we can gather today and openly worship you. Father, in your word, you instruct us to pray for those who are mistreated and persecuted for your name's sake. And so we do. Strengthen them by your presence. Grant them the perseverance to remain faithful and proclaim the glorious declaration in the gospel. Help us faithfully serve you and love others in a way that showcases your goodness and glory. O Holy Spirit, help us hunger for righteousness. Open our eyes to see wonderful things in your word and enable us to obey your voice and live to the glory of your name. And these things we ask through Christ our Savior. Amen. Please remain standing as we read from God's word together.
As we dive into a service morning and dwelling in the word, it's so important that we together spend time as God's people who he has called to holiness, a life of holiness, to reflect him in that manner. Let's read this together from Ephesians chapter 5. Starting in verse 6, says this. Ephesians 5 says, "Let no one deceive you with empty words, for because of these things, the wrath of God comes upon the sons of disobedience. Therefore, do not be partakers with them. For you were formerly darkness, but now you are light in the Lord. Walk as children of light, for the fruit of the light consists in all goodness and righteousness and truth, trying to learn what is pleasing to the Lord. Do not participate in the unfruitful deeds of darkness, but instead even expose them, for it is disgraceful even to speak of the things which are done by them in secret. But all things become visible when they are exposed by the light, for everything that becomes visible is light. For this reason it says, 'Awake, sleeper, and arise from the dead, and Christ will shine on you.'" Amen. You can have a seat.
Well, good morning, Woodlands Church. So thankful that you've chosen to worship with us this morning. If this is your first time here at Woodlands, we want to extend a special greeting to you and a welcome. We'd invite you to text the word CONNECT to the number that'll be on the screen, 888-225-7675. That's a great number to store in your phone. It helps you get in touch with us, and we can use that to respond to questions that you might have as well. We would love to know how we can help you walk with Jesus. If you are worshiping with us for the first time here in person as well, we'd invite you to visit us at the Welcome Center right outside the main doors of the auditorium. We have a gift for you. Here at Woodlands, we have six priorities that all start with the letter G, and they help shape what we believe our purpose is as we help people faithfully follow Jesus. We want to be grounded in the Word. We want to be growing closer to Christ. We want to be giving of our time, talents, treasures, and going into the world. We want to be grace-filled, and we want to gather, both in large groups and in small groups. And each of these priorities plays out in different different ways. So in regards to growing, if you have recently made a decision to follow Jesus for the first time, or if you've made that decision at some point in your life but you've never taken the step, we have a baptism service coming up on August 29th. That'll be a Sunday evening at 5:30 p.m. at Buchholz Park. We invite everyone in the congregation to join us for that. Here at Woodlands, we believe Scripture instructs us, once we've made a decision, once we've chosen to follow Jesus, to signify that inward truth through the outward reality of being baptized. And if you have not taken that step of faithfulness, we'd invite you to text baptism to the word on the screen. You can also go on our website to the What's Happening page to get more information. But we'd love to sit down with you, talk to you about that decision and what it means to be baptized. As we talk about going into the world, we're hosting a Red Cross blood drive here coming up on Thursday, August 26th. That's a way that we can impact our community positively because of our faith in Jesus Christ. And so we'd invite you to text BDRIVE. We went through a lot of different words that you could text, and blood just sounded a little creepy. So we decided BDRIVE. So text that into that number. We'll get you more information about how to participate in that. And then giving of our time, talents, and treasures. We want to thank especially those of you who have made the commitment to regularly commit your to support your home church through giving. There are three ways you can give here at Woodlands Church. They're on the screen. There are boxes in the back as well. We thank you so much for your support of the church. And then as we think about gathering, ladies in particular, there's an event coming up in just a few short weeks that we would love to tell you about. Turn your attention to the screens.
Hi, ladies. My name is Brianna Blakey.
I'm Megan Hippengarner.
And we are from the Women's Ministry team, and we are so excited to tell you about an in-person event coming up on August 17th from 6 to 8 called Dinner on the Patio.
Bring your pocketbooks. We're going to have food trucks there from Kaysen's Barbecue and Stone Press sandwiches and paninis. It's going to be so yummy.
So good. I'm really excited to have something kind of different for Dinner on the Patio. We will also have ministry tables for you to check out so that you can get involved and connected in Woodlands Church to make a big church feel a little bit smaller. I think we have seen that being connected and having community is super important in our walk with Christ. We would love for you to join us August 17th from 6 to 8.
And you can wear casual, I'm gonna upgrade it to jeans, this is my new formal wear, but we would love to have you either way. Joggers, jeans, doesn't matter. We'd love to see you there.
Just come on out, we can't wait to see you.
When I spoke his name into Google, at first it gave me John Cena because maybe I mispronounced it or maybe Google doesn't even remember him. But John Sununu used to be the governor of New Hampshire many years ago, and then he left the governorship of New Hampshire to become chief of staff for first President Bush. And guys, could you give me a sermon clock that I can understand? There you go, thank you. That one was in Swahili, and I don't understand Swahili. John Sununu became chief of staff for President Bush, the first President Bush. And one day, a reporter asked him and said, "Is your job difficult?" And he immediately said, "Nope." And chief of staff, if you know anything about the job, is an extraordinarily important job, extraordinarily complex. And so the reporter thought he didn't understand the question. And so he asked him again. I said, "I'm not sure you heard my question." I said, "Is your job difficult?" Expecting that he would elaborate. He said, "No." And then he told him why it wasn't difficult. He says, "Because I only have one constituent. I don't have to please all the people of New Hampshire anymore. I have one person that I have to please, and that's President Bush. I have to serve him." It's really important in life to know who you are and to live out your identity. That's a great analogy, that story, for us as Christ followers. We, too, serve a master, a leader, a king, an audience of one. But we want to think about our identity. We want to flesh out a little bit who we are, because the more we understand our identity in him, to him, for him, the more life will make sense, the more fruitful ultimately our lives will be. So we want to think about our family identity as Christ followers this morning. So open your Bibles with me to Ephesians chapter 5. Before, however, we dive into our family identity, and the text that we're primarily in is going to give us three different word pictures of what our identity is as Christ followers. But before we dive into family identity, we're going to go back and finish up family values. Last week, we were looking at the values of Christ followers, and we looked at our hearts, we looked at our speech, we looked at our deeds, but we didn't get to finish our sexuality. So I want to go back and finish what the Bible says about the family values as they relate to our sexuality and how we live that out. A very timely topic, obviously, in this day and age. So we're going to start at Ephesians chapter 5, where we read this morning. Actually, before that, we're going to start at verse 3 as we finish up from last week. Here's the text, Ephesians 5, verse 3. Immorality, but immorality or any impurity or greed must not even be named among you, as is proper among saints. There must be no filthiness and silly talk or coarse jesting which are not fitting, but rather giving of thanks. For this you know with certainty that no immoral or impure person or covetous man who is an idolater has an inheritance in the kingdom of Christ and God. Let no one deceive you with empty words. Because of these things, the wrath of God comes upon the sons of disobedience. So it's given you three words for each area of our lives where family values are. So for our sexuality, here are the three words that arise out of that passage. Our sexuality is to be pure, faithful, and honorable. Our sexuality is to be pure, it is to be faithful, and it is to be honorable. Let's unpack those words a little bit. When he begins and says, immorality must not even be named among you as proper among saints. Immorality is the Greek word porneia, from which we get our word pornography. And it is a broad word to describe any and all kinds of sexual impurity. Any and all kinds of sexual deviation from God's standards for us as people. So he says, any kind of sexual immorality is not even to be named among us. We are instead to be pure. He says, any immorality or any impurity. And then the third word that I've come up with is immoral, pure, faithful. It's kind of taken from this next phrase, and commentators differ on this as to what was in the mind of the Apostle Paul, or more importantly, in the mind of God when he inspired this passage. But he says, but immorality or any impurity or greed must not even be named among you. Verse 4, he's talking clearly about sexual impurity and immorality. He repeats those three phrases in verse 5, impurity, immorality, and greed or covetousness. So the question is he talking about sexual immorality and greediness and covetousness? Or is he using greed and covetousness to describe the way we take a greedy heart for someone else sexually? And I think the majority of commentators probably land on that interpretation. The fact that it's woven together, he's taking us back probably to one of the Ten Commandments, which says, don't covet your neighbor's spouse. One of the things we are not to covet. So he's reminding us of the call to be faithful to the sexuality, the sexual expression that God gives us. If we're married, then we should live out faithfulness to our heterosexual spouse. If we're single, then we should live out faithfulness to our singleness until God grants us, if he chooses to grant us that, a heterosexual spouse. So let's review what are the standards. If we're going to be faithful to God's sexual standards, if we're going to be pure, what are God's standards? God's standards are there is no sex to be practiced outside of the covenant relationship of marriage. And marriage is only between a man and a woman in the eyes of God. That's God's standard. It may not be the standard of our country, but that's God's standard. And so anything apart from that is a deviation away from that. And it is impure and it is immoral, and we are to stay away from it. I find it interesting, the third word that I came up with for this passage, besides pure and faithful, is the word honorable. Because he says that even our speech, even the way we think about sex, even the way we talk about it, should be honorable. Look at verse 4 again. He said, there shouldn't be any kinds of filthiness, silly talk, coarse jesting, which are not fitting. In other words, we should, and then it says, but rather be thankful. We should be the people, we as Christ followers should be the people who understand that sex, as God designed it, is a good gift from God to be exercised in the context of a heterosexual, lifelong, monogamous relationship called marriage, a covenant relationship. And if God leads us into that, if he gives us that gift, instead of the gift of singleness, which is also a kind of gift, that we should be thankful for, but we shouldn't demean it. We shouldn't coarsely joke about it. We shouldn't slide into thinking of it in a dishonorable kinds of way. You know, truth in this area is so important to shape the way we think about all of our life, but sexuality in particular. Just recently in our local Stevens Point paper, there was an article about a pastor, female pastor, who was clearly living in an immoral, according to the Bible, sexual relationship as a pastor, openly doing that. And as I read the article, one of the quotes struck me. She said this. She said, "There's nothing that tells me that the love that I share, the adult, consensual, loving relationship I share with my partner, is anything but holy. There's nothing that tells me that it's anything but holy." And I stopped when I read it, and I almost wanted to say out loud, "Have you read the Bible? Have you actually read the pages of Scripture? There's nothing that tells you that what you are doing that is spoken against multiple times in Scripture is not wrong." That's why we have to let our sexuality not be shaped by the culture, not be shaped by our passions or our feelings, but let it be shaped by God and His Word. When I read a little bit more of that article, I understood what happened for that particular pastor. She said that in the faith tradition she was a part of, there were four things that helped you determine what's right and wrong. One of them was Scripture. But on a par with Scripture were experience and reason. Well, if you think that way, then experience means, what do I feel like? Reason means, well, there can't be anything wrong with living the kind of lifestyle that I want to live if it feels good and feels right to me. And so reason and experience can quickly trump Scripture. But we are the people who believe that Scripture trumps pretty much everything else. And so that's where we get our cues from. I love the story about Dennis Rainey. He kind of illustrates for me how we should live out pure, faithful, honorable sexuality. Dennis Rainey is the head of Family Life Ministries, and he likes to tell this story. He said that while he was inside a mall, do you remember malls? There used to be malls years ago that were functional, and now they're turning into churches. I guess that's a good thing, actually, that that's happening around our country. But he was in a store. He doesn't name the store, but I'm pretty sure when I tell you what he saw on the walls, many of you who've frequented clothing stores for young adults will know the name of the company. When he was there with his 13-year-old daughter, she went inside to try on something while he was shopping for his 13-year-old daughter, and he noticed as he turned around that there was a full, life-size, completely nude picture of a young man on the wall. And so he went up to the manager of the store, a young man, and he shared with him. He said, I have six children. I'm a very good customer, but this picture, I'm sorry, it's just indecent. I thought I'd get agreement, he said. Instead, he quipped back and said, I beg to differ with you. By whose standards? A little stunned by his response, I replied with firmness, by any standard of real morality, sir, if that picture is not indecent, then I would like you to get in a similar pose to that guy in the picture right now. I don't think I'd have that kind of boldness. You know, I'm a little nervous I'm even telling you the story here in church this morning. He looked at the picture. He looked at my daughter. Then he looked back at me. There was a moment of silence full of anticipation. He shook his head and said, uh-uh. I smiled and said, you know, it's a good thing you didn't drop your pants because you could have been arrested for indecent exposure. Then he replied, well, if you think that's bad, that poster, you should see our catalog. So I did. I went over and I opened the catalog. One photo showed four teenage girls in bed with a boy. I pushed the catalog back and said, I'd like you to take my name and my phone number. I'd like someone from your corporate office to give me a call. To which he politely said, sir, I can take your name and address, but they're not interested. They really don't care what you think. My response was kind but firm. I said, I just want you to know I'm only one customer. I'm just a daddy of six kids, but I have a lot of friends. And I want you to know that wherever I go, I'm going to use this episode as an illustration of a company that doesn't care about the future of our young people, their morality, or the future of our nation. And so I'm telling you this story. He was true to his word. Then he challenged us when he told this, tells this story. He says, one of the greatest lies of our day is that one man, one husband, one woman, one mother can't make a difference. As a single man, you can protect the innocence of a single woman you are dating by being a noble man of character. As a husband and a father, you are a warrior who has been charged with the duty of pushing back against the evils that seeks to prey on your wife, your daughters, and your sons. As a mother, you can courageously teach your daughters the values of God and not the values of the world. So stepping up to courageous living as a Christian starts with us. Will we live by the standards that God has given us? So that's what our sexuality should look like. It should be pure, faithful, and honorable. So let's shift now. We're going to shift gears and shift to our identity. So in the passage we're going to read now, he's going to give us three metaphors for describing our identity. Let's kind of quickly walk through them. And the first one is that we are to be light and not darkness. He sets all of these up as contrasts. If you want to know who you are, he's saying, you, Christian, you, Christ follower, are light. You're not darkness. So let's read the passage again. Verse 7, do not be partakers with them, for you were formerly darkness, but now you are light in the Lord. Walk as children of the light, for the fruit of the light consists in all goodness and righteousness and truth, trying to learn what is pleasing to the Lord. Do not even participate in the unfruitful deeds of darkness, but instead rather expose them. It is disgraceful even to speak of the things which are done by them in secret. So notice in this text, he doesn't say to us, he doesn't say about us as Christ followers, he just doesn't say, you live in the light. He says, you are the light. God has made you, Christ follower, light. He's talking, and you're going to see in all these metaphors, he's talking about the fundamental change of identity that God works in our lives when Christ comes into our life. He fundamentally changes us. He makes us light, not darkness. Light is defined. It's easy to know what this metaphor is because he defines light in verse 9. The fruit of the light is goodness, righteousness, and truth. Of course, by contrast, darkness is a metaphor often used in Scripture for sin. And Jesus told us in John 3, verse 19, he said, the Son of God has come into the world, the light of the world, the Son of God has come into the world. He said, but people love darkness because that's who we are by nature fundamentally. We are people marked by sin. We all have this sin problem. And so we gravitate toward darkness. And when Christ comes into our lives, he's changed us so that we shouldn't gravitate toward darkness. We shouldn't like it like we used to like it. It shouldn't be second nature for us to drift toward darkness. It should be our first response to move toward the light. Many passages of Scripture talk about, use this analogy of light, darkness. I'm just going to read a couple for you about how that's our identity. In Acts 26, verse 18, when Paul is giving, or when, excuse me, God is giving his commission to Paul, he says this, I'm sending you to open people's eyes so that they might turn from darkness to light, from the dominion of Satan to God, that they could receive forgiveness and an inheritance among all those who have been sanctified by faith in me. In Colossians 1, verse 12, it says, we give thanks to God the Father who has qualified us to share in the saints in light because he rescued us from the domain of darkness and transferred us to the kingdom of his beloved Son. And then in 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 9, it says this, you are a chosen race, Christians, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for God's own possession, so that you may proclaim the excellencies of him who's called you out of darkness into light. Made us light. That's our identity. All of those passages of Scripture remind us that the fundamental nature of being a Christian is that God has changed, only addressed our doing. It said, this is what you should do, this is what you shouldn't do. It gave us the standard. But the law in and of itself gave us no power to be something different than what we are by nature, sinners. Christ came, and when we by invitation invite him into our lives and surrender our lives to him, he fundamentally changes us from the inside out. He gives us the power to do because he's changed our being. That's why it says again in the text, it says you are light, not you are in the light, you are the light. And that's why it says, so walk in the light, because that's who you are. Be who you are is the emphasis of this text. It's interesting in this text, it goes on to say that we shouldn't even get close to the darkness we used to live in. Go back to Ephesians chapter 4. He says it's disgraceful even to speak of the things that people do, who we all used to do before we came to Christ. In verse 11, he says, don't participate anymore in the unfruitful deeds of darkness, rather expose them. I remember so clearly, you know, you have those brief conversations sometimes with people, where there's a little phrase or something that someone gives you, and I remember being in a conversation, I don't know what the context was, obviously we're talking about spiritual themes, and someone gave this analogy to me, which just has helped me so much through the years. He said, you know, if you look at the whole tenor of the New Testament, he said, the tenor of the New Testament, if this edge of this carpet represents this is righteous and this is darkness, this is not, he said, the whole tenor of the New Testament, what God tells us is not get as close to the line as you can without crossing over. That's not what the New Testament says. It says stay as far away from the line as you can, because the closer you get to the line, the more it tends to draw you in. And it's just really helpful for me. Like, don't push the boundaries. Don't say, well, you know, God doesn't really say I can't do that, or God doesn't really say I can't get close like that. I was reading an article by a guy, and he was courageous enough to tell this, but he was telling about, he's a young man, and he's married, he's telling about a television show, a very, very popular television show, that involved a fair amount of violence and a fair amount of sexuality, but it was a fairly popular show. And a lot of their friends were watching it, so they started watching this show. And so even though this show had a lot of violence, it tended to objectify women instead of treat them as the people that they are, as the image bearers of God. And they started watching the show, as the guy said, the show was changing the way I thought about stuff. He said, the way I thought about women was changing because of that show. The way I thought about violence and expressing anger and violence was changing, because so often that the angry expression was applauded in that show. They had to just turn it off. It was a reminder to them that we're called to be light. We're not called to live our lives standing on the edge of the line, seeing how close we can get to it. Yeah, we have to step over here and love people who are still in the darkness. That's our calling. But we don't live here. We live here. And that's where we get our values from. So be light, not darkness. That's the first part of our identity. The second part of our identity that he highlights is he says that we are called to be wise. God has made us wise, not foolish. There's a contrast set up again, where he says, live your lives, Christians, Christ followers, as wise people, not foolish, because Christ came to make you wise, not foolish. Go back to Ephesians 5. We'll pick it up at verse 15. It says this, therefore, be careful how you walk, not as unwise people, but as wise people. Make the most of your time, because the days are evil. So then, do not be foolish, but understand what the will of the Lord is. So there's a one principle, one identity. We saw earlier in chapter 4 that one of the things that God repeatedly says in his word that he uses to transform us when we come to him is he transforms us by transforming our minds. And a great passage is Romans chapter 12, verse 2. It says, do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. So what God does is he makes us wise. He changes the way we think about life, the way we understand or don't understand truth. and that transforms us. So we are to be people who walk in the wisdom of God's truth, in the wisdom of God's words. We are to walk as wise people in truth. And then he gives us two practical applications of that, two ways that we live that out to show that we are indeed living as wise people. In verse 16, he says, make the most of your time. The days are evil. Literally, the phrase, some of your versions translated this way, it is the literal translation. Some of you have it in the margin. Literally, it says, redeem the time, because the days are evil. Because all around us as Christ followers are still darkness. Days are evil. It's all around us. It's easy to cross the line, to slide back into it. So redeem the time. Make sure that you're using the same amount of time that all of us have to move closer to your identity in Christ, to live more faithfully in that identity than rather to drift back into darkness. Redeem the time. Buy it back. I love what Moses wrote in the only psalm that he wrote in the whole book of Psalms, Psalm 90. He talks about the brevity of life. He talks about how we're like a vapor, we're like dust, you know, quickly our lives pass. And then he says, and he utters a prayer in Psalm 90, verse 12, to God. He says, so teach us, in light of the brevity of life, teach us, God, to number our days. Sounds like, teach us to redeem the time. Teach us to number the time that you've given us. Last phrase, so that we might present to you, God, a heart of wisdom. So that we can get to the end of our days and say, we have lived wisely because we've allowed your truth to shape us. The second implication of living as wise people rather than foolish is in verse 17. He says, don't be foolish, but another contrast, but instead understand what the will of the Lord is. So we live as wise people when we make it our pursuit, we make it our habit to try and understand what is the will of God for our lives. You know, I look around this room and you guys are at all different stages of life. You know, you're male, you're female, you're young, you're old, you're married, you're single, you're working, you're not working, you're retired, all different stages of life. But through every stage of life, God says to us, know what my will is for your life. This is what the text says. Understand. It's a command. Understand what the will of the Lord is for you, where you are. So in general, there are two theologians and Bible students that help us understand that there are two kinds of wills of God that are described in the Bible. One is what's called the general will of God. This is the will of God that is the same for me as it is for you. It's the same for the person across the auditorium as it is for you who are watching online. And as John Stott famously puts it, the general will of God is this. He says, the will of God for the people of God is revealed in the Word of God. I like that. The general will of God for the people of God is revealed in the Word of God. So you want to know what in general, and he tells you a lot about how you should live your life. You look here. This is his will for you. This is where your sexuality is addressed. Your honesty is addressed. All kinds of things. Your character is addressed. This is where the general will of God is. But there's also a particular will of God, and that has to do with who we marry or whether we marry at all. It's about what kind of job we take. It's about how many children we have. It's about the nitty-gritty of life. Do I choose this or choose that? You choose one thing, you've said no to 10 other things. How do you know? Does God care about those choices? I believe he does. You see many examples in Scripture of God leading his people into particular places, closing doors. Read through the book of Acts, and God says to his church, go here, don't go there. So there is a particular will of God for people that we can follow. And how do you discern that? If it says know what the will of God is, and it's not just a general will of God, how do we discern that? Here's some principles. We discern the particular will of God for our life. Become an engineer, not a doctor. Or, you know, become a carpenter, not a plumber. The Bible won't tell you that. But the Bible gives you general principles about how you live your life. People have found the principles about having enough time to care for their children, for instance, about the responsibility to raise up their children has shaped career choices they've made. So principles of Scripture help lead us into the particular will of God for our lives as well. Thoughtfulness. And then over time, God, this is the way he tends to lead for most people. He gives you a sense, a settled sense of peace. His Spirit leads you into the good works that he's prepared for you to walk in, Ephesians chapter 2, verse 10. But learning to follow his will is very much both a science, because it's from Scripture, but also an art. I love what Andy Stanley said once. Andy Stanley is pastor down in Atlanta. He talks about, some of you will remember this, he said back in seventh grade, they tried to scare us to death about using alcohol. He said, I remember we saw a film about a party where students danced and listened to music. One guy invited his friends to the back room for drinks. Another guy passed out. They couldn't revive him, so they called the ambulance. He was rushed to the hospital where someone called his parents. Mom was crying. Dad was crying. The doctor stuck needles in his veins and tubes up his nose. The moral of the movie was, don't drink alcohol, or they'll stick needles in your veins, tubes up your nose, and your parents will cry. He said a little bit later, they brought a very similar movie into us seventh graders about using drugs with some of the basic points. Another time, he said, while we were seventh graders, we actually got to touch the lung of some poor soul who had died from smoking. The object of the movie was, if you smoke, your lung will look like this and kids will touch it. We were convinced in the seventh grade that none of us would ever smoke cigarettes. Then there was another movie they brought in seventh grade that showed us in driver education course, where professional photographers got on the scenes of accidents, it seemed like, before the police even arrived, and took pictures, gruesome pictures of accidents. And he said a lot of us decided the theme of that movie was, don't ever get in a car again. Andy Stanley writes this. He said, we seventh graders were convinced that under no circumstances would we ever drink, smoke, take drugs, or drive recklessly, if at all, would we drive. Yet soon after we entered high school, most of my friends were smoking, everybody was drinking, and I lost several of my friends to drug overdose. So how could we be so convinced about something that something was deadly, unhealthy, and unwise, and yet not act on our beliefs? Today, he writes, many of you are involved in things that a year or two ago you never dreamed you would do. What happened to my friends? What happens to us? And he writes, what happens is that we only have preferences and not convictions. We have information, but we don't let it land in our soul and shape our minds and our hearts. When the Bible says, be wise, walk like wise people, it's saying take the truth of God and let it enter into your soul and shape your life, make you different. Well, there's one more metaphor here that we're going to look at this morning. If you want to go back to your Bible in Ephesians chapter 5, and we're going to pick it up there in Ephesians chapter 5. He goes on to talk about and give us a command that's a little bit unusual and the things he puts together, but let's read it. Ephesians chapter 5, verse 18. Do not get drunk with wine, for that is dissipation, or debauchery is another word, but be filled with the Spirit. Speak to one another in psalms, hymns, spiritual songs. Sing and make melody with your hearts to the Lord. Always give thanks for all things in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to God, even the Father, and be subject to one another in the fear of Christ. The third identity that we have, by way of contrast and comparison, is we are to be spirit-filled, not darkness-driven. We all have an internal engine, if you would. You want to think about it that way. Something that drives you. Before you come to Christ, it's just sin. That's what drives us. When we come to Christ, the Spirit of God comes into us, and he wants to fill us and lead us away from the sin that would destroy us. He illustrates, or he brings us this command by saying, don't get drunk. Now, you have to understand, this is not a major teaching on alcohol in the Bible. There are major teachings in the Bible on alcohol. This is not his purpose here is not to give us a major teaching on alcohol. He's using alcohol by way of comparison and contrast to teach us where he wants to take us, which is be filled with the Spirit. And so he says, don't get drunk, rather be filled. So he's making a comparison. Like, what is the comparison? Comparison is, well, what do we say about someone who's drunk? They are, quote, under the influence, right? Someone who is controlled or filled by the Spirit is under the influence of the Spirit. There's a comparison being made. What do we say about someone who's drunk? It changes the way they act. It changes their behavior. If you've ever been around someone who's really just stone drunk, you'll know that their speech changes, their personality often changes. Someone who is controlled and led and empowered by the Spirit is changed fundamentally. That's the comparison. But he's also making a contrast. The contrast is that, you know, being filled with the Spirit is very, very different than being drunk. Drunkenness leads you to debauchery, leads you away from God. Being filled with the Spirit leads you toward Him. British preacher Martin Lloyd-Jones was also a medical doctor, and he said, if you go to any medical textbook and look up what alcohol is, it's listed as a depressant, not a stimulant. It depresses the more rational, better senses of your mind. You lose control in a bad sense when you're under the influence, when you're drunk. He said, the Spirit, he said, I think functions much more like a stimulant, if you want to follow that analogy. He stimulates us to righteousness, to God's way, to God's will. And so the command here, let's look at it again in verse 18, is this. Do not get drunk with wine, rather be filled with the Spirit. There's a lot in that little phrase, be filled with the Spirit. First of all, the language of it is very, very important. He says, be filled with the Spirit. Remember in the Greek language, you can learn a lot about digging in a little bit to the tenses and things of the verb. So this is a command, be filled, reads that way in English. But the verb in the original language is in the passive tense. It sort of is in English as well. And it's in the present tense in the Greek language. So the command is constantly, that's present tense, allow yourself, that's passive, to be filled by the Spirit. That's the command. That's God saying to us. This is your identity. Your identity should be one who is constantly letting the Spirit of God fill you. So what then does it mean to be filled with the Spirit? To be filled with the Spirit means that I remember years ago someone told me that, first explained being filled with the Spirit with these two phrases. Said, to be filled with the Spirit means to be controlled and empowered by the Spirit. I like that. Controlled and not in the sense that you're a puppet, but controlled in the sense that you are led by the Spirit. That's one way to think about what being filled with the Spirit is. Think about what the Spirit of God came to do. He came to lead us in life. He came to empower us to do God's will. I like this phrase a little bit better. Instead of CE for controlled and empowered, here's another little word that you can remember. What filled with the Spirit means is the word let, L-E-T. Instead of controlled, I like the word led. So to be filled with the Spirit is to be led by Him, L, is to be empowered by Him. But it's also T, to be transformed by Him. Remember, the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. So what is it? How do you obey this command? You obey this command by praying, God, today, would you lead me this day into what you want me to do, how you want me to live? Would you empower me this day to do your will? And would you transform me? Changing my darkness into light. Change my life. Let me close this morning with a fascinating story. Back in 1871, the Great Chicago Fire destroyed much of the city of Chicago, 1871. Surprisingly, the flames started on one side of the Chicago River, and the city of Chicago at that time was on the other side of the Chicago River, but somehow the flames got across the river and though destroyed most of the city. Question for years was, how did that fire jump the river? Jump the river, it's speculated possibly by wind, that had something to do with it, possibly by some wooden ships that were in the river. But here's the other part of the story that people forget. At that time, the Chicago River flowed into Lake Michigan. It emptied into Lake Michigan. And every imaginable waste produced in the city of Chicago was dumped into the Chicago River, and it flowed into Lake Michigan. It was called the Stinky River, the Bubbly River, by people at the time. It was so polluted, it was actually combustible. And so probably the flames burnt across the water. The city of Chicago was drawing drinking water from Lake Michigan while they were dumping the waste from the slaughterhouses into the Chicago River, which was draining into Lake Michigan. And so from in the 1880s and the 1890s, every year at least 10,000 people died from cholera and other transmittable diseases. In one year, 1885, the number was 100,000 people. And so finally, the city of Chicago did something, which is amazing, still considered one of the greatest civil engineering feats of the day. They reversed the flow of the Chicago River. They dug 28 miles of canals. They moved more earth and dirt than even in the construction of the Panama Canal. And on January 2nd, 1900, they had built all these canals to take the Chicago River and have it drain into the Des Plaines River, ultimately into the Mississippi River. And so they let the water of Lake Michigan into the Chicago River to push all that junk out. Send it down the Mississippi. That's a great solution, don't you think? But why I tell you that story is because they fundamentally changed the nature of the Chicago River. Many historians believe that had they not done that, the city of Chicago would not exist today. But they changed the river. When Christ comes into our lives, he changes our identity, changes who we are. We have to let him do that in our lives. We're going to close our service with prayer, so please stand with me for closing prayer this morning. Father, thank you so much for your grace in our lives that you sent your Son to do what we could not do, to change us, to change our very identity, to change our being, to change us into light and not darkness, to change us into your sons and daughters, not your enemies. And so we pray that by your grace and the power of your Spirit, we could live that identity out day by day. We pray in your name. Amen. God bless you. Have a great day.